Father, we come before you this morning, grateful to be in your presence again. I pray that you'll be with us in this time of worship and a time of listening. Help us to hear your heart, Lord. In this time when things are pretty crazy in our country, we need more than anything else to hear your heart, your voice, and get your direction. We pray for you to give us wisdom in this time of strife and confusion, and that you will give us the light that will guide our path. Holy Spirit, take over the service. Let your words be spoken. Bring us heart to heart with the living God, for we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. So a few things coming up this week. Thursday, we do have our Bible study, and we'll be meeting in person in the loft, and that's at 7 o'clock. But if you're not able to make it, and or if you don't want to, you can still access it through Zoom, so you can still be a part of it through Zoom. Saturday, we have changed our evening services to 7 p.m., and we encourage families without kids to come Saturdays, because we're trying to keep our count at 25 and having the kids be able to take advantage of the loft and the lookout on Sundays. Please let us know what service you are coming to, because the seats have to be rearranged. And let us know as early as the end of this service if you're able to come Saturday or Sunday, and no later than Friday, please. Tuesday, which is not this coming Tuesday, but next Tuesday is June 16th, Diane is starting back with Grief Share, and that's going to be from 6:30 to 8:30 in the loft, and this will be the first of 13 weeks. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Alexandra. Cross isn't on. I will fix that. One moment, please. Technical difficulties. Did that do it? Nope. There's two ways of doing it. That way was wrong. There it goes. Okay. Now the next question is, are the colors changing? Or is it just one color? Is it changing? Yes, it's changing, right? Went to green, went to blue. We should be good. Okay. Got to have our cross on. Just have to. What will we do without it?
And while we're having the technical difficulties, everyone's dismissed as well.
Oh.
Not everyone.
Can I go? I want to go. I've been watching Alexandra's lessons online. I want to go there. Shh, no one else. No one else. Just me. That's fine. You all stay here. You're stuck. Okay. Wow, a small group got even smaller. Now I know how Gideon felt when God was choosing his army. Okay, that's how this is going to be. All right. I don't have any extra announcements to add, except if anybody wanted to know why we're... Diane? Yeah, so for those people listening at home who couldn't hear Diane because we didn't give her a microphone, one thing about the Grief Share, we're starting it over. It was kind of in process when we got shut down, and she's starting it over. So if there's somebody who has not come but wanted to get into it, you can start at the very beginning now. So anybody who is watching online, we're broadcasting, so say hi so we know who was there. And we hope very soon that we're going to be back to whatever normal is here. But until then, we're going to keep doing the RSVP thing, I think, for at least one more week. We're green now, whatever that means. So I think they're going to invent new colors, because green doesn't really mean green. You think green means go, but it's not quite go. It's like go in first gear, but not quite go. And we're not 100% sure what the qualifications are on the church. They're trying to be a little bit careful there because of the whole separation church and state thing and the whole constitution thing that says they can't control religion. So they're being a little bit gentle there, but we're trying to be respectful at the same time. So anyway, for right now, stick with the RSVP. Isn't it nice coming in, being met with a maitre d', be shown your seat, you know? You tip the maitre d', you get a better seat. That means the one in the back. Noah paid the highest. That's why he's sitting all the way in the back. But those of you who didn't tip, you got stuck up front. So that's how it goes in church. It's a little bit different than a restaurant. Okay, so that's it. Let's go ahead and start our sermon. Okay, so we are continuing on our Survivor series. We're in week 5 now. We started last week into kind of a mini series, and amongst the series, we're going to talk about leadership. But actually, the reason we're doing leadership is because leadership reveals your character. Your character gets revealed in leadership. So what we're really talking about is character. And most importantly, we're talking about Daniel, the guy we've been talking about the whole time. We're talking about his character. And because his character made him successful, and that only is something that maybe should encourage us because he was very successful in a very difficult time, it also should encourage us because he's considered one of the most godly men in the Bible. And that's what we should be trying to aspire to be, is more godly. So when we're talking about leaders, though, we have to recognize that there is a difference between someone who wants to be a leader and someone who just wants attention. We've kind of seen a lot of that going on in the past couple of months. People get a little bit of attention. They just kind of get hooked on it. In the game of Survivor, if you remember, this is a Survivor series, so we kind of tie it back a little bit. But in the game of Survivor, they always put these people with very large personalities in the game, stick them on an island together and watch them interact. That's kind of the fun of it. So we get to watch some really crazy, crazy people have to deal with other crazy people. And it's fun, you know, because we can sit back and eat our popcorn and watch it. But one of the biggest personalities they ever had showed up, and this is this guy.
I'm the CEO of my own software company, but are there other layers to me? Absolutely.
I'm a former federal agent. That's right, Special Agent Shepard. That was my first and middle name for years.
First and middle name, Special Agent, right? This guy was really interesting because he starts off like trying to dominate the tribe because, well, he's a special agent, former special agent. And so it doesn't go well. Before very long, everybody hates him and really doesn't want to vote him off. And he gets a little crazy. I don't know if it's deliberate, just he went nuts. He's dressed in purple underwear most of the time running around. And they got so tired of seeing it that two of the women took it out of the laundry and like buried it someplace on the tree because they got tired of seeing him in his purple underwear. He puts feather in his hair and tries to commune with his dead great-grandfather. It really gets weird. And eventually we have to, you know, his leadership skills were not there because leadership does not develop character. It reveals it. And that's the thing about, I think that we wish it weren't that way. We wish that our leaders would develop character of leadership, but they don't seem to. I don't know if you've, again, been noticing. Leadership is kind of a crucible that displays what your character is. Now, you may have character traits that you're developing and you get better at. That does happen with the good leaders. But the bad leaders, it's not how it works. And so eventually, this guy who actually ends up being the leader describes what ends up with Philip Shepard. This is pretty good.
But it doesn't take a genius FBI man to figure that out. All you have to do is look at their faces and watch their lips moving. The FBI, whatever, special agent, he is a piece of work. I think he's a good-hearted guy. I do. It just might not all be there. Let it be a lesson to you. Government jobs are stressful.
Yeah, that's kind of how I think we've seen going on. These government jobs must be stressful because they seem to be cracking up amongst it. But the real point of all this is the character reveals your heart. And in God's world, you're selected for leadership based on your heart, which is coming from your character. Remember David was picked for why? Because he had a heart that was turned to God. And your heart will show off your character. The character is just basically the manifestation of what your heart is feeling. And we see this in scriptures. We see it in Proverbs. Above all else, guard your heart. Why? Because everything you do flows from it. Everything that you are, everything you see, everything you say, it's actually flowing from your heart. Jesus says this when his disciples, and they're talking about eating unclean food. And he says, what goes in your stomach doesn't defile you. Actually, what's coming out of the mouth is what's defiling you because that's coming from the heart. For out of the heart comes all evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false witness, slander. These are what defile a person. Jesus is saying, look, if you want to know what's bothering, what's really creating the issue with that person, it's not what they ate. It's what's in their heart. Because what's in their heart reveals their character. All these things come out of it. So what we're actually looking at, we're looking at leadership, and we're looking at leadership because we're looking at character. So Daniel's character was defined by two important characteristics that I want to talk about today, as timely as today's headlines: dignity and respect. I think there's an awful lot of that missing in today's dialogue and what we've been watching on television or YouTube or however you guys get your news these days. If you've been watching it happen, we've seen an alarming lack of dignity, an alarming lack of respect. So I want to talk about that, but before I do, I want to define this a little bit. The righteous dignity, which is what I'm talking about, righteous dignity is seeing yourself as God sees you. Now we're going to look in a minute at Daniel and see how he had that really clearly. But if you can see yourself the way God sees you, you will have that dignity, but you cannot let your circumstances change that, because God doesn't change. The way God views you isn't changing because of your circumstances. He didn't decide to hate you, and that's why your circumstances are bad. That's not what's going on. God loves you, and your circumstances don't change the fact that God loves you. False dignity is demanding what you think you deserve. We see a lot of that. People demanding respect, and they basically want to get what they want to get because they're worth something. I deserve this, and therefore, I will take it. I'm now going to do something I don't like doing. I'm going to talk about some social aspects going on in the country because I don't think I can ignore them. And it's so crazy. Like last week, we talked just a little bit, and it seems so different now, 1 week later. It seems like a month has passed because so much is going on. But let's talk about COVID-19 for a minute. Remember that? It seems like it's gone from our dialogue. But we have these. And, you know, these are kind of like, here at Spirit Chapel right now, these are like an attorney. If you don't have one, one will be handed to you, right? Because everybody has to have one in case someone walks in. Everybody's kind of finding their own way with this. But what's happened with this mask is it's become political. It's pretty remarkable. You can almost know how people vote by whether or not they're wearing a mask when they're outside, especially when they're going into businesses. Because somehow along the way, this became a symbol of government authority. I don't know why, but it seems to be. And so if you see someone who's voluntarily putting on a mask and wearing it, your natural assumption is that person believes the government's basically good, they're taking care of us, and we should follow their edicts. And then there's the other people who will not wear these for any reason whatsoever and tell you, I'm an American, I don't need a right, they never ask me to wear this, I'm not going to wear this. I believe in the individual's rights and liberties. And so what you're doing with your mask ends up becoming a declaration, not just of how you feel about COVID-19, but how you are acting as an American, right? So I want to challenge that today a little bit, because I think that we need to act as Christians, not as Americans, and I don't think we should act as scared children either. So just so I'm clear, just if anybody has any question of my stance on this, I don't think we need these. If I thought there was a 1% chance that somebody in this room had COVID-19, we wouldn't be open right now. I promise you that. Because I recognize we have some people here who are on the category that they might get hurt if they got it, and I wouldn't take that chance with my people. So I don't think there's a 1% chance. That's not a political thing. It's because I've been paying attention to COVID-19 since early February when I first read about it on the internet. I thought, oh, what's this? You know, I've been studying it. And when Allegheny County put up their little map, which some of you may have noticed, I don't know if you know that, but there's a map. You can click on it. You can see COVID cases. But that's not cases that are there. It's cases that were reported, right? There's a big difference there. COVID only lasts about 2 weeks. And the cases right now in Elizabeth Township is 5. If you go to the map, check last night just to make sure. 5. 1 Elizabeth Borough, 2 and 4 Township. Not sure where Clarendon was. I think there are about 8. And I got to be honest, I wasn't checking Clarendon. For those of you living in Clarendon, you need to go check it yourself and follow it. I was checking the township because I was curious, you know, what's going on. Lincoln Borough was 0. But those 5 in Elizabeth Township were there like week 2 of them having that up there. That's like almost 2 months ago. COVID doesn't last for 2 months. After about 2 weeks, either they're in the hospital, they've passed on, or they're still in Elizabeth Township, but they're fine. So when I watch that and I see no new cases in the township for a month, do I think that we need this? No, I don't. In fact, I would say that we had a Passover this year, praise God. It passed over us. It's real. It hit. It hit New York. It hit Detroit. It hit in places of Louisiana especially, some really bad places, but praise God, it seemed to pass over us. And I don't know why. They don't know why. They're guessing. They really don't know why. So do I think we need this? No. But I, like you, have carried this in my car and still do. This is like the new fuzzy dice, the 2020 fuzzy dice. Everybody has it hanging from their windshield wiper. Some of you made windshield wipers, but you, the rearview mirror. And so we've all got them, right? Some people have an assortment of them. I love that. You know, it's like, well, this is my Monday mask. We have them. And I have them in my car, too. We have them in the back. I have them. And when I go into a business, especially if I don't know their rules, I take the mask with me. And I walk up, and if I see a sign that says this, you know what I do? I put the mask on. Do you know why? Because it's not my store. And for whatever reason, the owner of that store has decided that for the betterment of the store and his patrons, they want you to wear a mask. And so I wear a mask. And if I don't like that, I'll go to a different store that doesn't require me to wear a mask. But I'm not going to say, too bad, my rights supersede your rights. Since when does that happen? When do my rights come before what the business wants? It's their business. They've clearly done something right in their business because I'm going to it, right? It's selling something I want there. And so I'm going to go there to get it. And so they're doing something right. But what am I going to do? Say, well, I'm sorry. My rights supersede yours. I'm not going to do, we have a thing you probably had growing up too. My house, my rules. You know, my dad set the rules. He controlled the temperature and the thermostat. My house, my rules. You're going to somebody else's business, their rules. And so I'm going to respect that. Because I don't know why they have those rules. It might be that they're lemmings, sure. Well, they're foolish. That might be the reason. Or maybe it's because they're afraid that if they get caught letting people in without masks, they can have a business license revoked. And I wouldn't want to do that to any of the businesses I do business with. I want them to be around. You know, somebody reported, I don't know if you guys saw this, the little red hot dog stand up there. They reported them. They were outside. They didn't even know who was there. It was a mom and dad. There's a mom and pop shop trying their best to get their hot dogs and French fries out as best they can, right? And somebody reported them, and they're begging people, please, 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 you know, follow social distancing outside because we don't want to get shut down. We don't want them to get shut down either, but I have rights. You know, I have rights as an American. I have rights. And here's what Paul says about your rights. I have the right to do anything, you say, but not everything's beneficial. I have the right to do anything, but not everything is constructive. We need to define some respect and some dignity, and we need to be the people who are leading the way in this. I don't like wearing them either. I wear this long enough, I feel like I've been breathing in a paper bag, and I have to go outside and get some breath. But I'll respect the right of the owner to set up the rules for their shop, and I'm not going to overrun it. Now, here's the interesting thing. I talk to people about that, and they don't see it that way. But it's really easy to see it when it's somebody else. So let me spin off of this crisis that seems to have almost gone away magically overnight. And let me talk about the other crisis that we see happening today in our country, and that's the racial tension and the protests / riots that are going on. And we see a lot of activity there. And I don't know if you've been paying attention to this because it's almost hard to watch, right? So it started off, of course, in Minneapolis. And when they started rioting, you saw people breaking into the Target and taking things. L.A. riots, though, I love this picture. This is from the L.A. riots. This is a group of people who are rioting, and they're walking by the Apple store. Then wait a minute, and they break the windows there. This guy's carrying an iMac. That's about a $5,000 computer. That would run our whole church. It's got a couple iPhones and iPads, you know. We interrupt this protest for a smash and grab. It's poor people in Minneapolis, they're grabbing things from Target. LA's getting this in Louis Vuitton bags, too, which just tells you that when it comes to riots, it's like real estate, location, location, location. You know, it's much better to riot in LA. But you look at that and you go, this is awful. This is horrible. This is terrible. They are robbing that store. Yeah, let me put that in a different way for you, though. What they're doing, because this store, the Apple store, they have rules. That's why they have windows up and everything. And their rules, and you might think these are crazy rules, but their rules are if you want an iMac, you're supposed to buy it. That's their rules. And that iMac's on display so people can look at it, not steal it. But this person here said, I don't care. I have a right to do what I want. And he walked through and he took it and left with it. That's what's happening here. And I would love to know how that is any different from this. It's just another level, right? It's just take it to another level. So instead of me not wearing a mask in Lowe's, I steal a lawnmower. It's pretty much the same thing. I'm walking into the store and I'm disobeying their rules and doing what I want because what I want supersedes absolutely everything. So we gotta see this as for what it is Because Jesus says, and I said, well, Pastor Grace, you can't possibly say that stealing an iPad's the same thing as not wearing a mask. I'm telling you, it's the heart. Because Jesus tells us, if you look at your brother with hate in your heart, it's the same thing as killing them. Now, Jesus knows there's a difference between murder and hate in your heart, but he's saying it's all flowing from the same heart, and it's still sin. And that's what I'm saying. I don't like it either, but that's what I'm doing. I want to say just a little bit on what else is going on with the racial protests, though. I just have to say this because this leads into, I think, pretty nicely, the conversation about Daniel. Because I don't know if you've noticed things, but things are different. Some of you are as old as me. Some of you, a couple of you are older than me. A lot of you are almost as old as me. So you guys may remember what we had going on in the 60s. I was born in the 60s. Barely remember it, except I remember everybody being scared. But I also remember because Martin Luther King Jr. was murdered in 1968. I was too young to really remember that. I was 8 years old at the time. But we studied him in school, I'll tell you what. And so I understood what all that was about and why he was doing a great thing, a great man doing a great thing. They were marching to get the right to vote. It seems crazy today, but they didn't have the right to vote. And so that whole march and the whole protest was to bring awareness to this bill that was before Congress that was going to give them the right to vote. And that's what that was all about. And it turned violent, by the way, not because of anything Martin Luther King did, but because the police turned violent. So there's kind of a history here of violence inside of riots. But today, it just seems like people just want to get noticed, you know? Like if we were to take today and mash it together with that great, great march of the old days, it would look something like this, you know? Hey, excuse me, can I get a quick selfie here in front of Martin Luther King? It's nuts because it seems like people just want to get noticed now. And I don't know if you've seen some of these, but people are calling them out. Like people are, celebrities are holding up nothing and taking a picture and then having them Photoshop a sign in later. I don't know if you've seen this. They're calling them out. They're fighting this. But people just want to be noticed. And so I look at this whole thing and I kind of don't understand, you know. And I'm trying to understand, maybe like some of you, and you're probably confused like I'm confused. And here's my problem. My problem is I have never lived in fear of the police. Now, I actually have, I work with and I know a lot of really prominent black people who have advanced degrees and really nice homes. And they've told me stories about getting pulled over. And they told me how they're fearful of what might happen next. And it's real. I mean, it is real. I don't understand it because I've never lived that, right? I really don't understand it. But the problem also is I've never lived as a racist either. So I don't understand either side of this equation. I'm kind of in the middle somewhere. I don't know if you guys know who this is. I mentioned her before. This is Miriam Curry is her name. Here's a picture of her with her son, General Curry, first black two-star general in the Army. This is Nancy Reagan. This is in our National Archives. If you look at it, it says, Nancy Reagan posing with General Curry and two unknown people. Well, this is General Curry's wife, and that's General Curry's mother. We were very close to this family growing up, so close, in fact, I didn't call her Mrs. Curry. I called her Grandma because my mom called her Mom. She was like a spiritual mother to my mother. And I grew up with them, and that was how I grew up. I can't remember how old I was before I heard the first racial slur in my life. I don't even remember it because it's just, I didn't grow up that way. So I don't know. I don't know how to put myself on either side. I'm trying to understand, but I've never been a racist. I've never been afraid of the police. And so I'm trying to figure things out. But here's what I do know. There seems to be a lot of people talking about this R-E-S-P-E-C-T thing. And I don't know if you saw this going on, but in Philadelphia last week, not this weekend, but last weekend, there was a line of police, and I feel sorry for these guys, because they can't even engage. They're basically standing there as a symbol almost. They're lined up in front of a building to protect it. And a bunch of the protesters ran and one for one lined up in front of them. So they made like two lines. Like so in the front line was the protesters, in the back line was the police. Every protester was blocking a policeman because a crowd was coming, right? They're actually trying to stand between the crowd and the police. And as this huge crowd is approaching, the guys in front were shouting back at the police, take a knee, take a knee, take a knee, like Colin Kaepernick, take a knee, take a knee. And the crowd got near him, and finally the captain of the police gave the order, and they all took a knee. And everybody cheered and moved on, right? And here's the thing. I don't know who those people were. Some of those policemen, by the way, were black, which like makes no sense at all. But in that line of policemen, I don't know them. It's possible that some of them in that line were racist. Completely possible. Let me tell you something. If they were racist before they took the knee, they were also racist when they got up from taking the knee. It changed nothing. In fact, all that would have done was harden their racism in their heart, because I said, this is why I'm racist. Look what they're doing. And all the people looking at this with shock, as a lot of us are, who aren't racist, we're looking at it with shock. And those who are racist, they're looking at it with anger. And they're like, you know, we need to, you know, that's why we need to keep them in their place kind of thing. And no hearts or minds are being changed. None. This is changing nothing. It's just solidifying our current positions. That's all it's doing. In fact, we've been doing that in America for a long time now. But here's the thing about respect. Respect can be given. Respect can be earned. But respect can never be taken at gunpoint. That's not how respect works. It's not. But we're going to talk about Daniel. By the way, don't shoot me. I'm just the messenger. But that's the way respect works. We're going to talk about Daniel, because I'm going to show you how Daniel had dignity and was able to treat people with respect. And I want to show how that changed the dialogue that he had with these people. Now, I'm not going to go through all the sermons that we've preached for the past 2 weeks, but I'm going to show you Daniel's character in the story. Last time we talked about his actions. This time I want to talk about his character in the stories. Because it really shows us how we need to treat people with respect and how we need to have dignity. Those two things. What Daniel had was dignity. He knew who he was. He was chosen by God. In fact, he was specially chosen by God. He may not have known that. Because after they pull out, you remember, Jeremiah comes and God gives a prophecy about, he doesn't name him, but it's Daniel. And how he's going to be with him and bless him. God knew Daniel's heart. And Daniel knew that he was prized and precious to the living God, as you all are. And he never let that change him. I've said this before, but this to me is really remarkable. When he gets to Babylon, they rename him. The king himself says, I will rename you because you're like my children, and your parents blew it with their names. I'm going to give you my name. I'm going to call you Belteshazzar, he tells Daniel, which is Nebuchadnezzar's god, Bel. It means belongs to Bel, is what Belteshazzar means. That's your new name. And Daniel said, thank you very much, but it never was his new name. His name was Daniel. Because Daniel means the one who loves God, Jehovah. And he knew who he was. He was Daniel, not Belteshazzar. And I think it's really interesting that it's the book of Daniel, not the book of Belteshazzar. I said, well, what difference does that make? Because this was in the Babylonian library. That's how we find it. They called him Daniel. So the king tried to change his name, but it didn't take, because that's not who he was. And he had a dignity because he knew who he was. On the whole trip there, they try to break him down. They try to teach him, you know, turn him into dirt, just like basic training tries to do to people, only worse, because they don't want them to rebel. And so they're trying to break him down, and he, you know, he falls along. He can't do anything. He's a slave. He's pulled off in chains. But in his mind, he knew, I am the son, the child of the living God, and he loves me. And nothing these people are going to say or do to me is going to change God's view of me. So Daniel had this dignity about him. And you can see that in the way he approaches people with no fear, because he knows who he is. So, of course, the first test when they get there is they you know, give him new names, they give him change of clothes, let him clean all up, and they put him to eat at the king's table. And what Daniel sees is a bunch of food that's been already sacrificed to idols, false gods, and a bunch of things he's not allowed to eat there. Poor Daniel, because one of those things was probably bacon, but he's not allowed to eat it, right? And so he says to his three guys with him, you know, there's 70 who weren't, but these three guys with these four guys, they said, we can't defile ourselves by eating this unclean food. Now, I want to put yourself in that situation now. You haven't eaten for days. We're not right. They give him, you know, just bread and some cheese or something. So they're starving, they're really hungry, and they can smell this, oh, is that cumin I smell? That smells so good, you know? But they can't eat it. And they tell themselves, we're not going to eat it. What do you do next? Because I'd like to believe that I would have the courage that Daniel and these three guys did. I'd like to believe that, so I'm going to give myself that. I don't know that I would, but let me pretend I had that much. Here's what I would do next. Well, look, it's family style here. You know, they bring them out. That's the way they serve, these big plates of food. Let's just take the clean food. No one even has to know. We're going to pinky swear amongst ourselves that none of us will eat unclean food, and we're going to just eat the clean food. and no one will know. It'll be our secret between us and God, like a secret fellowship of God. That's what I would have done. But that's not what Daniel does. Daniel says, no, there's somebody who's actually in charge of us, and it's important for us to maintain that. So instead of us just sneaking off and doing what we want to do, I'm going to talk to the one who's in charge and offer him the respect to ask him if it's okay. That's nuts to me. He's going to talk to a pagan eunuch who serves a pagan king. And by the way, a pagan king with a temper that if he gets mad at you, it's choppy chop. Like, Daniel, he's never going to agree to this. I could hear me there with Daniel. Daniel, you're going to blow it. He's never going to agree with this. But Daniel didn't care. Why in the world, I was asking myself this question as we prepare the sermon, why in the world would Daniel have the confidence to go and talk to a pagan who's serving a pagan king about observing a Jewish tradition to Jehovah, a god Babylon thinks they've destroyed? Because when they come, they say, your gods are not going to save you. And then they conquer them. See, your god didn't save you. They think their god Bel is greater than God Jehovah. Why in the world would Daniel have the confidence to go and stand before him? I mean, he could be taken off and whipped for this. And say, you know, I don't want to eat this because Jehovah said not to. And I've made a promise to him that I won't. And so I'm not going to. Is that okay by you? Why would he ask that question? It's nuts. Doesn't make any sense. And here's why, I believe. Because Daniel knows that none of this works without God's help. He's like, yeah, none of this is going to work without God's help. We're not making it out of here with God's help. We're going to serve God in a pagan land with people over us where we're slaves. We have no rights, none. None of this works without God's intervention. So what he's doing is he's leaving room for God's miracle. Do you ever just leave room for God to work in your life? Because I have a hard time with that. I try to get things done down to the nth degree. I got to get this done. I got all these details I got to get taken care of. And I know I got to get them all taken care of. Don't bother me right now, God. I'm working on the details of this. It's a real problem. I'll talk to you later when I'm ready to praise you. Not ready now. I got to fix this. Down to the nth degree, I got it all worked out. I would have had a plan of how we could have eaten that food with nobody knowing. I have had everything worked out. We could wash off some of that food, all of it, everything. And Daniel's like, no, we need to leave room for God. We're going to be obedient, and we're going to say, God, this is what we want to do. You know our hearts. You know why we're doing this. But we're going to leave room for you to work. And if you don't work, we can't do this. We recognize that we're stepping out in a place that only faith gets us there. The only way I can stand is on faith. But I'm leaving room for God to work in my life. See, a lot of times we don't. We don't need God until we need him. And then we've tried everything and it falls apart. Then we can run into God. Right? But he's actually leaving room to have God work in the very, very beginning. So he goes in there, but this is scripture he couldn't have possibly known because it wasn't written yet. But later, Paul, maybe thinking back on Daniel, will say this: everyone has to submit to their governing authorities, for all authority comes from God, and those in positions of authority have been placed there by God. I had a really hard time with this growing up, as you might imagine, some of you who know me. But I actually, I'm not going to go into the whole story, but some of you know this story. My high school girlfriend, I wasn't allowed to date her because her parents said no, and we snuck around. It was horrible, looking back on it now. But at the time, I thought, love trumps all, so I'm not going to obey the authority that God placed over her, right? The relationship didn't go well, as you can imagine. Learned a lot of lessons because I was saying, I'm not going to respect the authority. But the Bible tells us to respect the authority. I didn't leave room for God in that decision. I got this, God. I can sneak around and make this work. And what God was trying to get me to do was step forward and speak to the parents. Oh, I'm not doing that. So I circumvented authority instead of submitting to authority. That's no respect. By the way, that's no dignity either. If you're a sneak, you don't have dignity. Anyway, but what happens when Daniel goes before this guy and says this is an amazing thing. The respect Daniel shows the person in charge shows back to Daniel. Because he took the pressure off. If this man is having his authority questioned, he's going to come back as an authoritarian. But instead, Daniel goes to him, whether this guy likes it or not, kind of as an equal. but one who is willing to submit to this man's authority. Jesus does the same thing in front of Pontius Pilate. He's saying in front of Pontius Pilate, and Pontius Pilate says, do you not know I can kill you right now? I have the power of life and death over you. Jesus says, no, you don't. You have no power except the power my Father gave you, but I'll stay here, right? Jesus stayed there because he didn't have to. He could have said, I'm out. You know, Michael opened the door, and the archangel would take the sword, you know, and be all over. That's how Jesus could have it, but he says, no, I'm going to be submit. That's what meek means, by the way. Meek means power under control. That's the definition of the word meek. It's not someone who's sneaking around and trying to get. No, it's I have authority here. Because I have dignity. I know who I am. I know who my God is. But I'm going to submit to the authority by choice. So Daniel goes to this guy and he says, yeah, you're in charge of us, but let me tell you what I want to do and why. And instead of this guy going, shut up, your God's dead. He says, okay, Daniel, I appreciate this. But here's my problem. A couple of days from now, or whatever, when everybody else is eating well and you're eating this apples and fruit or whatever, you're going to look horrible. And I'm with the guy on that. I'm sure if I was on that diet, I'd look horrible. He says, and then I'm going to be in trouble for it. So I can't do that. So, you know, really at that point, what I would probably do is say, well, okay, I tried, God. Let's go sneak it or something like that. But instead, he just kept leaving room for God's miracles. He said, look, if God can do this miracle, he can do the next one. And so he says, all right, I'll tell you what. Here's what I'd like you to do. Why don't we do this for 10 days? Would that be fair? And in 10 days, test us. And he actually says, whatever test you want, test us however you will. And if we can't keep up with them, you're right. I don't want to do anything that's going to cause you difficulty. But if we can keep up on them, can we keep on the diet? And this guy said, yeah, sure. But I want you to see that he didn't put any qualification on the test. It could be that horrible rope test, you know, some of you guys, I don't know if they do this anymore, in gym test, see how fast you can climb up the rope to the top of the gymnasium. Those of us who couldn't get more than 5 feet up, right? They used to do that in gym, climb to the top. It could have been that test. It could have been an endurance test. They're going to take their fastest runner and say, okay, Daniel, let's see if you can keep up with this guy. He said, whatever test you devise, it didn't have to be academic. It could be physical. It could be anything. And they don't even tell us what he tested him with. All we know is they gave him a battery of tests, and in every test, Daniel and his three friends outscored everybody. And that guy must have gone, well, I don't know how you're doing it, but keep doing it. You're the top of the top. Well, how they're doing it's a miracle. How could he do that? How could he make that claim? Whatever test you want. Because he knows this doesn't work without God's miracle. If you're already in with God, you can't out promise him, right? I can't possibly come up with something God can't do. So he's willing to go in and say, yeah, I'll do this. Again, if he does not allow this to happen, then we're going nowhere. So he actually steps out on faith and saying about the miracle. Now, we see the Apostle Paul come in, and he basically tells us that we're supposed to grant respect to absolutely everyone. He says this. This is actually kind of a weird scripture to me. He says, look, I'm free. He says, I'm free. I used to be a servant under the law, but I'm free now, he says. I'm free from all men. Nobody has any control over me, but I have made myself a servant to all. See, I have the dignity as a free man, but I've actually made myself a slave to all. And there's only one reason. I'm trying to win them to Jesus. And then he goes and says, well, how he's doing it. To the Jews, I am like a Jew. Well, he is a Jew. But he says, but I emphasize my Jewness to the Jew, that I might win them. To those who are without the law, Gentiles, then I will speak to them as one who doesn't even have the law, because I know I'm no longer bound under the law. I can do that. And if I come to someone who's weak, I'm going to go to them as someone who's weak. I'm going to do anything. I have become all things to all men that by some means that I can save those who are under the law. I will do anything short of sinning, in other words, in order to save people. Wait, is Paul saying it's okay to deceive and lie people for Jesus? That's not what he's saying. That's not what he said. He starts by saying, I am free. That's dignity. I know who I am. I'm a child of the King. I know who I am. But I am willingly going to empathize with all these people and meet them where they are and give them the respect we can empathize without compromise. I'm going to give all these people respect I'm going to sit there and say, oh, yeah, you're keeping the law. Hey, let me tell you about how I kept the law. I was a Pharisee. Oh, you don't believe in the law. Well, let me tell you, I used to be a Pharisee. I don't keep the law either. Right? Because he's sitting with a lot of Gentiles who think, well, we can't possibly come to Europe because we're not Jewish and, you know, we've been unclean our whole life. Yeah, I know that, but that's okay. I was unclean too. Jesus saved me. If they're weak, if they're strong, it doesn't matter. He was able to do all that. He was able to give respect and empathize with anyone. He gave them that respect because he knew what his dignity was. Change that. So he said, we're going to keep doing this because we need to reach these people. Don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be humble, thinking of others as better than yourselves. But don't look out only for your own interest. Take interest in others too. This is real simple. Dignity and respect. Paul had it. Daniel had it. Real quick, I want to talk about this other thing we talked about last week, his dream. Do you remember that dream thing? I never actually finished that story. In that story, you go back and actually, I can't catch the sermon online. It's not online. Sorry about that. We'll get it up online. Anyway, but if you missed it, you catch that. But basically, Nebuchadnezzar had a dream, and it really messed him up, and he was worried about it. And so he called all of his magicians and all the king's horses and all the king's men. You know, must have been really drunk. You're calling the horses in. But whatever, you call them all in, and he said, hey, who can help me with this dream? But here's the deal. You got to tell me what the dream is, and then you got to tell me what it means. No one could do it. He says, okay, then you're useless to me. I'm going to kill you all. And he just set an edict out, kill all the wise men. Well, Daniel wasn't in the palace at the time. He and his guys were out in the field doing field work for everybody. And the guards went to get him to bring him back to the palace and kill him. Now, that's a tough situation to be in. But again, Daniel respects the authority of the person who came to get him. He said, whoa. Why does the king want to kill all the wise men? He says, look, we're all going to be dead in 24 hours if God doesn't step in with a miracle. But we've been here before, guys. You know, it's kind of part of what we do. We leave room for God's miracle. So I told the king we can do this because we're either dead in 24 hours and we'll see God, hallelujah, or God's going to step in and do a miracle, in which case, hallelujah. Either way, we're good. So I need you guys to pray. I'm going to go to bed and ask God to give me a dream. And so he does. He does all that. So he goes, and after a very good night's rest, how he did, I still don't know. He goes and has his audience with the king. Now, I did talk about this last week. He goes before the king. Now, we will see in a moment that Nebuchadnezzar never thought anybody could do this. He knew the Chaldeans were liars. He knew they were. He never believed any of it. He has them there because it made him look important as a king, but he knew they're a bunch of liars. He never thought when Daniel came, this kid who just, by the way, 2 years ago was a slave in chains. 2 years ago. He was supposed to be in school for 3 years, but he was so good he graduated a year early. And so here he is standing before him, this kid. He's probably 20 years old at this time. He's probably 17 when he was taken, 20 years old. Now, actually, 19 years old. And he's standing before the king. He says, well, let me try where everybody else has failed. Yeah, go ahead. I'll give you a day. And then I'm going to kill you. He never thought this was going to happen. So Daniel walks into the king, and the king says, well, tell me, you got anything? And I love what Daniel says. He starts it off by saying, no wise man, enchanter, magician, or diviner could possibly explain to the king the mystery he has asked about. He has shown Nebuchadnezzar what's going to happen day to come. He said, I'm going to tell you what this dream means, and I'm going to tell you what it is. I'm going to tell you why God gave it to you. He's got the whole thing. And he describes it. I'm not going to describe the dream, but in detail. But there's a statue he saw, Nebuchadnezzar, and it was gold on the top, and it kept getting worse as it got down until finally the feet were made out of clay. Have you ever heard the expression they have clay feet? I know it's something that's probably not used very much, but clay feet—that's where this comes from. And eventually, this statue will fall and crumble. And the king Nebuchadnezzar knew in his spirit somehow that meant something, but he didn't know what. And Daniel said, "God is revealing to you what's going to happen, not just in your kingdom, but in all the kingdoms that follow you." This is a little tiny timeline of what's going to happen to Babylon and every other kingdom. And then he says, here it is. He broke it down. And Nebuchadnezzar is blown away. Nobody could have known the dream, let alone the interpretation. Daniel's putting it all together. And what happens next is really, really incredible. As he describes the dream to him, the next thing that happens is when Daniel had finished, King Nebuchadnezzar fell prostrate before him. He worshipped Daniel like a god. The king of the greatest empire on earth just bowed before Daniel. And yet he knows Daniel's not a god. He knows he's just the mouthpiece of the God, and he can't even Imagine Daniel. Whoa, what's going on now? King's bowing to me? Because nobody could know this. The king knew he gave an impossible task. He knew it. Nobody could do what Daniel just did. Nobody. And he says to him, surely your God is the God of gods. 2 years ago, now the king is bowing before the God's servant and saying, I can't even stand before the servant. Your God's the God of God, the Lord of Lords, the kings and revealer of mysteries. For you are able to reveal this mystery. And then the king placed Daniel in high position. Well, you think? Gave him many gifts. No, get out of the field, Daniel. I'm going to put you in charge of everything. He made him a ruler over the entire province of Babylon and placed him in charge of all the wise men. But Daniel says, no, 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 no. King, thank you. But you know who really deserves this promotion? Not me. These three guys who helped me with this. They deserve this promotion. And at the request of the king, he appoints Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah as administrators of the entire province. Now, we don't know these guys by these names for some stupid reason. These are their real names. We know them as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, which are their Babylon names. But his three friends, he says, you know what? They deserve this promotion. I will stay here and just simply be your advisor. He walks away from the promotion. Do you know why? Because Daniel knows something. Those who pray are as important as those who preach. I stand up here and talk. I am not more important. Because Daniel knows I'm not going to say anything to you at all. Them, not me. What about the Chaldeans? Now's a good time to chop them up, right? He doesn't even bother. The Bible says this. You don't have to worry about these guys. Don't worry. The integrity of the upright will guide them, but the perverse will destroy them. They'll take care of themselves. The blessed will smooth his way, but the wicked will fall by his own wickedness. The Lord says, am I not storing up all these things? Take revenge. I will pay them back. Will arrive. Just we can let that stuff go. And here's, you know, I said we have to leave room for God's miracles. One more quick scripture and then we'll wrap up. Paul actually has another way of pointing out. Leave room for the wrath of God. Like let him destroy him. He'll do a better job than you. Is that, you know, what he said? No, no, you're going to hit him. It means nothing. Let God smack him. Look at him, all right? Because it says, vengeance is mine and I will repay, says the Lord. So we only have to leave. Much, much better than you ever would. Listen, we have to learn how to know who we are. We have to know the dignity that God wants to have. And then we have to use that to offer respect to the people around us. We should be walking through life with dignity and respect. We really, really should. And in order to do that, we are going to have to leave room in our lives for God's miracles to work. Would you please pray with me? Heavenly Father, I thank you that you have taken us to a place . Teach us, Lord, how to leave room for you to work in our lives so we can see your miracles, and that builds trust and faith because we do serve a God. Country. We need people to understand. We really need people to understand true respect, and we need to be your feet here on earth.
Woke up today, another headline, another innocent life is taken in the name of hate. been mistaken. My heart is breaking.
Tell it, DC. All the
fingers taken.
That our families will come together right now and seek your face. And you'll heal our incredible land. In the name of the only Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Keep you. May Lord may his face shine upon you and be gracious. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace in Jesus' name.